Richard II is a play crafted by William Shakespeare around the year 1595. It's alternately classified in its time as both a historical play and a tragedy. This play serves as the opening act in what some scholars dub the Henriad, a tetralogy that includes Henry IV, Part 1, Henry IV, Part 2, and Henry V. The setting is approximately 1398, and within the next 2 years, Richard II will meet his demise. Currently, however, Richard II holds the throne as the King of England. As a monarch, Richard displays several deficiencies. He mismanages the kingdom's finances, expending resources on insignificant military endeavors, all while surrounding himself with self-serving advisors. Richard's reign has not only incurred the ire of commoners due to his taxation policies and his overall disconnect from the populace, but has also drawn the ire of the nobility, as he seizes their properties and levies fines for ancestral wrongdoings. The play commences with Richard presiding on his throne, striving to mediate a dispute between Henry Bolingbroke, one of Richard's cousins, and Thomas Mowbray, the Duke of Norfolk. Henry accuses Mowbray of embezzling royal funds and being responsible for the murder of Henry's uncle, the Duke of Gloucester. Henry's own father, John of Gaunt, suspects that it was Richard who schemed to eliminate the uncle, John's brother, to acquire his land for the crown. However, Henry, at this point, does not share those suspicions. After their failed attempts at reconciliation, Richard decrees that the dispute shall be settled through a trial by combat. Just as the battle between the two adversaries is poised to commence, Richard abruptly terminates the proceedings. He banishes Henry from the kingdom for 10 years, later revising the sentence to 6 years, and banishes Mowbray permanently. The sudden and seemingly arbitrary decision deepens suspicions that Richard is, indeed, behind the uncle's demise. Possibly burdened by guilt, Richard opts for a somewhat reduced sentence for Henry. Conversely, by permanently exiling Mowbray, Richard may be attempting to sweep the conflict under the rug. Henry's initial suspicions turn into outright anger after John's death and Richard's seizure of Henry's rightful inheritance. Recognizing that Richard has lost the favor of both commoners and nobility, the popular and naturally charismatic Henry begins plotting a government overthrow while Richard is away leading an expensive war with Ireland. This war serves as the reason behind Richard's appropriation of lands from fellow nobles. Henry marches his army into northern England, executing two of Richard's highest-ranking loyalists, Bushy and Green. He also attempts to persuade the Duke of York, who has been left in charge of the kingdom during Richard's absence, to join his rebellion. Understanding Henry's popularity among the people, the Duke of York decides to side with him against Richard. Upon Richard's return to England, his loss of control is so extensive that putting up a fight seems futile. Meanwhile, Henry successfully reclaims his lands and ascends to the throne as King Henry IV. In an effort to appear magnanimous, and considering he still harbors doubts about Richard's culpability, Henry opts not to execute Richard. Instead, he confines the deposed king to the fortress of Pomfret. However, Henry's reign experiences a turbulent beginning. The Duke of Aumeri, who happens to be the son of the Duke of York, orchestrates a rebellion with several other conspirators, all loyal to Richard. The Duke of York uncovers the plot and informs Henry. Despite the Duke of York's cooperation, Henry decides to execute all the conspirators, including the Duke of Aumeri. Only upon the heartfelt pleas of Aumeri's mother, the Duchess of York, does Henry relent. Following the suppression of the rebellion, Henry delivers a speech that alludes ambiguously to his living fear. The interpretation of this phrase raises questions. Does he mean that his fear possesses a vivid, tangible quality, almost as if it has taken on a life of its own? Alternatively, could he be suggesting that there is a living man who instills fear in him, namely, Richard himself? An individual named Exton, eager to win the king's favor, interprets it as the latter and proceeds to kill Richard. Publicly, at least, Henry IV disowns the murderer, expressing his intention to embark on a pilgrimage to Jerusalem, seeking God's forgiveness if he bears any responsibility for Richard's death. The ambiguity and uncertainty surrounding this event parallel Richard's own shortcomings as a king, as seen at the play's outset. This irony and foreboding cast a dark shadow over the beginning of Henry's reign. While often classified as a historical play by scholars, Richard II, especially in its conclusion, contains much of the tragic and psychologically complex elements found in some of Shakespeare's finest work. I hope you enjoyed this video, leave a like if you did, and be sure to subscribe. Thank you.